بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله.
الحمد لله. الحمد لله رافع السماء بلا عمد. أحمده حمدا كثيرا طيبا مباركا فيه كما يحب ربنا ويرضى. الحمد للإله ذي الجلال وشارع الحرام والحلال. حمدا لمن أرسل خير مرسل لخير أمة بخير الملل. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وخيرته من خلقه وخليله، أدى الأمانة ونصح للأمة، كشف الله به الغمة، وجاهد في الله حق جهاده حتى أتاه اليقين. فسبحانك اللهم لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا، إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. ربي اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. رب أدخلني مدخل صدق وأخرجني مخرج صدق واجعل لي من لدنك سلطانا نصيرا. ربنا وسعت كل شيء رحمة وعلما، فاغفر للذين تابوا واتبعوا سبيلك وقنا عذاب الجحيم ربنا. ثم أما بعد. To our brothers before me today, our honored sisters and mothers who came today, and our respected viewers worldwide, I pray to Almighty to shower His mercy and blessings unto all of you. I commence by praising Almighty Allah without any jot of hesitancy in my heart. I testify that the only worthy of worship is the ever-compelling Creator. And beyond peradventure of doubt, I bear witness that the seal of all prophets and messengers is Muhammad. Sallallahu wasallam ala nabiyyina Muhammad. Almighty has sent him with the truth, and that truth he had delineated unto the entire world. Those who wanted to accept, and those who accepted it, they became quintessential, successful individuals. And those who rejected the truth, regardless of their intelligence, intellect, and their own wisdom, they became in the bottom of history simply because they've denied the message of the final prophet. As what follows, I'm delighted to be before you today, you know, with my media team, having our parents to my right, now sisters likewise. I have before me my brothers in faith. We would like to talk about one of the most important cause of this deen. How to uplift ourselves with knowledge is the topic of today. But before I plunge into it, I would like to be grateful to my Creator subhanahu wa ta'ala for enabling and allowing me to be before He today. I understood the brother he met, he came to our fundraising over there in South Plainfield. Tirelessly he requested if there's any possibility of coming here today to speak. I did not give him a definite answer. I said, inshallah, we will look into it. Then he came back, he said, well, we're still waiting to see, we will look into it. And at the end he came, I said, well, then let's set it up today, the 8th of March 2015. And alhamdulillah, Allah had allowed me to make it. So I pray that whatever I will say today, Allah to scale it for him in the scale of good deeds on the day of judgment.
Amen.
And after that, also I pray to Almighty to bless your imam, the imam of this masjid.
Amen.
You know, sisters and brothers, it's not easy for an imam to give up his chair for somebody to sit on it in his own, you know, dominion in his own masjid, except someone whom Almighty Allah had opened his chest with piety, because it's not easy for a person to do that. So I pray that Allah bless him. You may not get this in detail until I set up an analogy and metaphor for you to cogitate and reflect. Do you think somebody will be sitting in his own country and then he gives up? He say, you know what? Since you visiting my country, now you the president, run it the way you want it. Do whatever you want to do until you leave. Nobody will do it. But he had done it, and I pray to Almighty to shower that in his own, you know, scale on the day of judgment. Now, as for you, our parents and our sisters coming here today, I understood we live in America. Some people, out of ignorance, they say, you know what? I understand and I know. You know, I don't know why you're taking the baby. You just need to give him some milkshake and let him sit and listen too. You know what I'm talking about? Yeah, just give him some little meek shake, you know, just let him shake it out a little bit so that he can get some good time. You say, we ain't know in Africa meek shake is going to be expensive. Not in America. Get some little fries along with that, that low Akbar for the baby. He will never forget the lecture after that. You see? I understand, you know, sometimes, ikhwan, when the babies cry, you know, some of us, we get upset, you know, because the baby is crying. Ikhwan, we shouldn't get upset, because the mother and the father, they love to listen to the words of God. That's why they came. So we should give them chance and not be upset, because those whom Almighty had given the chance, they did not respond. And yet they vigorously denying the favor of Almighty. They're the ones we're supposed to be upset at, not those who willingly come in to listen to the wisdom of Almighty God. So I pray to Almighty to bless the baby who just cried and the one who just shouted right now. You see? So, you know, if that was in Africa, the father just going to give some little fisabilah to the baby and the baby going to be quiet. Y'all know the fisabilah I'm talking about? You see? The baby just acting up, the father going to say, hey, listen, one of the two, either to shut up or I give you some. And once he receives that fisabilah, he just going to accept it. He know now I want to call. You know what I'm talking about. But we're living in the different world, so let's be mild. May Allah bless the United States of America. Amen. And give us peace. Amen. And save us from those who will temper that peace. And I pray to Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala to unite all of us under his shade on the day of judgment. So back to our topic, I don't know how you came up with this topic, but it takes a genius individual to sit down, think deeply, to come up with a topic as this topic today. How to lift up ourselves with knowledge, because wealth cannot lift you up. You can get a lot of dollars. You can have millions of dollars in your Wachovia bank. I don't know why I keep on saying Wachovia. Wachovia is close. You know, now we have Wells Fargo. You know, that's my bank. I was with them when they were Wachovia, so I kept on repeating it. You know, you may have like millions of dollars in your Wells Fargo or TD Bank or Citibank or Citizen Bank or Bank of America or whatever bank that you have your wealth in. That wealth cannot lift you up if you are ignorant. What lifts an individual is knowledge and wisdom. You don't have to be a Muslim to know this. Even non-believers and non-Muslims themselves, they believe in this concept that nothing uplifts you except knowledge. I ask you this, who was the fourth president of America? Sisters, who was that?
I don't want to put you on the spot. You know, ladies first, that's why I started asking you. You know, I apologize. Who was the fourth president of this country, America? The fourth. Not the first, the fourth. Where do those babies at? Where those college, you know, graduates and the university students and the high school students, where are they? Who was the fourth president of America? Huh? Somebody say Johnson. Who was that? I know you Google it up, right? You see, they Google it up. I get the trick. You see? Okay, in less than a minute, who was the next after James Madison? What did she say? Who was the next one, the fifth? You see, they didn't get a chance to Google it fast. So you see, the fourth president of America, he once said, knowledge will always govern ignorance. Knowledge will always be superior. Knowledge will always be on the top. Knowledge will always be above. And knowledge will always govern. And America had testified to what James Madison had asserted all the way in his days, when now America had come to discover that no way for an ignorant, dumb person to govern the whole United States. So if you do have the knowledge, you're the one that will run, and you're the one that will be in the highest office in the whole America. So in 1800s, it's almost impossible and even impossible for a black man to be in the White House. But since we in 21st century, and 21st century refuse for ignorant to be a leader, that person must be knowledgeable. Thus, even you black, they're going to put you in the White House. That's what knowledge does. If you have that knowledge, you're going to move. If you have that knowledge, you will govern. China today, in terms of business, if you yank China out of business, the whole, you know, the whole world's economy will just crash. And most of you, when you go in downtown in New York, or you come to Philadelphia, or you go to Chicago, or you go to Sacramento, or you go to, you know, California, all the time you see the Chinese with their cameras always taking pictures all over. Do you know what they're doing? That it's not just for fun. It's for imitation and emulation of governing the world. Whatever they see, they have to come up with something like that. Whatever they see, they have to make sure they come up with something, either exact or even better. If they cannot come up with something better than it, they're going to come up with something exact and lower the price for you. I bet you 90% of what we're wearing right now is made in China. Your kufi, if you twist, you may say, well, it's made in Nigeria. Twist the factory in Nigeria, you're going to see they came from China. That's knowledge. That's the power. Frederick Douglass, he said, knowledge is power. Knowledge is power. And that's why the leaders of the world, when they realize that no way for them to govern their own subject without knowledge, from childhood, they began to uplift their own children through knowledge. That's why there was a president, one of the former presidents of this country, and that's the 16th president. Google it, because I'm going to ask you soon. Abraham Lincoln, when he realized that his father is not giving him the chance of education, he detested his father so much and he hated his father so much because his father did not give him the platform and the classroom of knowledge. He became furious and very, very angry at his father. And then he said, if I don't have the chance through my own parents, since my mother is dead and my father deprived me from such, you know, beautiful way of life, meaning knowledge, I make sure I be the ultimate autodidact of the whole world. You know what autodidact means? Autodidact means a person who taught himself when there's nobody to teach him. So he said, if I don't have somebody to teach me, and I don't have the way, I will teach myself that knowledge. And there are four leaders of the world that they never been in high school, but they learned. Some of them never been in college, but they learned. Some of them did not sit in university, but they learned. Abraham Lincoln was one of them. When he realized that now he's losing it, he said, I have to teach myself. Then just jumping into college, after that going to law school, graduating from that, he said, I will make sure that those who had been undermined and simply blasphemed and utterly completely outshaded because of their color, I will come at the end through knowledge, I will emancipate those people. And do you know what happened? He started fighting in 1800s. You know, there was a war between the South and the North, right? He said, I have to make sure I ended up this. So he started moving. He started moving. And he said, you know what? Those people, I don't think I can overcome them through strength. So if I cannot come overcome them through strength, I have to come overcome them, you know, through knowledge. I have to overcome through what? Through knowledge. He said, okay, well, if that's the case, I'm going to run for president. And that presidency, I'm going to be part of it. He started running. His enemy tried to bash him, dash him, and wash him. And his own homie, Rhodey, they tried to wipe him. But they were unable because of the type of knowledge that he had equipped himself with. Long story short, he said, I have to drop the axe in order for me to move with my mind. Then he started searching, going. Long story short, he became the 16th president of the United States. At the end, he emancipated those whose color was regarded at the time as inferior. He made them to be what? Free. And the one who followed his suit and the one who took his route is the current president of this country, Mr. Obama. So knowledge, Ikhwan, I'm actually taking it to tell you, just like what the sister said, it's power. I'm taking it from this perspective before I will even attach it, you know, with some Islamic, before somebody sit down thinks, well, you're just talking about your own scripture. No, even those who did not believe in our scripture, they stood up and they bore witness of what the Quran had said, and they bore witness that knowledge is what leads, and they bore witness that nothing is better than knowledge. Just like what the scripture said, including Quran, the final testament of Almighty God. So if you Muslims, you have no value that you give to Quran, non-believers that did not have Quran, they respected the book, including the one who was in charge of writing the Declaration of the United States of America. And in 1776, in July 4th, that young man, almost 37, 38, he wrote down the Declaration. The person that I'm talking about is Thomas Jefferson. He had Quran in his library. And do you know some? How many hours do we have in a day? In a full day and night? How many? 24. Do you know how many hours he used to read? Every day, 24 hours. Every day, the amount of hours that he, 24/7, like in 7 weeks, you know, 7 days out of the week, 24 hours, he had made it upon himself. To read and sit in his library by himself, researching, reading, delving in the knowledge. He used to do this every single day for 15 hours. Every day he reads 15 hours. Now you tell me the researcher who can do it. 15 hours every day. And that's why those four to five individuals who were selected to document and to write down the declaration of this country. Four of them came together, but do you know the one who put and ink it down was Thomas Jefferson, though he was the youngest, after the youngest among all. That's knowledge. So now I've laid out this foundation. Let me make a U-turn when possible to come back to tell you this. You see? You know, we don't have to blame our brother, mashallah. Welcome, brother. Allahu Akbar. Because, you know, Muslims in media, we behind. So even if you have the media, we don't even pay attention. May Allah reward you with Jannah. May Allah bless you and bless all of you. The sisters, may Allah bless you. The brothers, may Allah bless you and give all of you Jannah. And give me Al-Firdaus. You see, I've been making dua for you. Say, I mean, now I made dua for myself. Yeah, you see, I mean for me. May Allah give all of us through those.
Amen.
You see? So that's how it is, Juan. MashaAllah. You see? So what we're trying to say today is that knowledge is what governs a person's life. And the first verses of Quran ever revealed by the Creator to our Prophet, peace of Almighty forever be upon him, the first 4 to 5 verses of the glorious book of Almighty Allah is none but knowledge. In chapter 96, page 597, verse 1 to 4, Almighty said to our Prophet, اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق خلق الإنسان من علق اقرأ وربك الأكرم الذي علم بالقلم علم الإنسان ما لم يعلم. Read. I don't know how to read. Prophet said, peace be upon him, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Read. No, I don't know how to read. اقرأ. Read. Ma ana biqari. I'm not learned. I'm not literate. I don't have knowledge. I never sat in classroom to learn. I did not ink something since I was born. I don't have knowledge. Iqra. He said, I don't have that knowledge. That is when our Prophet, peace be upon him, was in the cave and Jibreel alayhi salam descended upon him with the first revelation. He said to him, read. He said, I don't know how to read. And then he repeated the second time, twice, read, I don't know how to read. Thrice, read, I don't know how to read. Then Allah Almighty said to him, اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق. If you think you're going to read out of your own knowledge, human being, you have no power, you have no mind, you have no intelligence without the help of your Lord. So if not through the help of your Lord, even you know how to read, you know how to write, your knowledge will not benefit you if your Lord does not put barakah and blessing in your knowledge. Therefore, you're not going to read out of your own, you know, way of knowledge. It must be from the way that Almighty will bless you to read. اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق. So our sisters today, and our brothers today, and our respected viewers today, worldwide, wherever you may be, what we're saying is that knowledge, if you do have knowledge, and there's no blessing of God in that knowledge, the knowledge is going to turn against you. The knowledge is going to turn against you if there's no barakah and blessings of your Lord in it. That's why, اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق. So it's like Jibreel or Angel Gabriel is saying that if you think you're going to read out of your own power, no, you cannot do it. As for those who read and write thinking that they have knowledge and therefore they do not need God's Almighty's blessing, Well, Allah said we're going to give them the knowledge, but at the end, the knowledge is going to turn against them. But as for the believers who read and write out of our own fear and follow our command, their knowledge will benefit them so long as they live. Their knowledge will benefit them in their graves, and their knowledge will benefit them the day they stand before their Lord. That's the power of knowledge, ikhwan. It's the power of knowledge, sisters. So that's what Almighty mentioned. Alladhi 'allama bil qalam. He, Almighty, it is the one who taught everybody the knowledge of how to read and how to write. And whatever we do is documented and is written with pen. That's why he mentioned the time that there wasn't no human being on the earth to even know what pen it is before even putting ink into writing. That's why Muslims, our Quran is powerful. But the problem of Muslim is that, or human being at large, you know, when Almighty blesses a person with some, he doesn't see the blessing and always, you know, vision somebody else's blessing, and he forgets his until his is taken, then he appreciates what God gave him yesterday. People in peace, they do not appreciate the peace until the peace is taken. You will not know the amount of blessing that you receive from Almighty God just by being in peace until war erupts in your country. That's when you will know the value of peace. You will not know the value of health until you get yourself in the hospital as a patient when you cannot even stand up willingly until you get stand by people. You will not appreciate. Thank you. You will not appreciate, you know, the blessing of Almighty God on you. Thank you so much. You get me some purified water. May Allah allow you to drink from Salsabil in Jannah. And allow our parents and our mothers to cook for us, inshallah, some nice fufu in paradise. You know, I'm excited because today I see, you know, some of my, you know, homies. Why? Because, you see, for a very long time, I haven't seen that fufu. You understand what I'm saying, right?
Yes.
You see, so that's how it is. You see, so the power of knowledge still, ikhwan. So when you are blessed with some, you know, oftentimes a person does not envision the blessing until the blessing is taken. That's the nature of human being. You see, the eyes widely open, mimicking, opening all the time. You will not appreciate your eyes until just something little just drop on your eyes. And now when you start scratching it and turning red, that's when you will figure out, man, I didn't know I had eyes. But the eyes been there for a very long time, but you did not recognize. You see? So always, the person's blessing, it's not admired, but the person will keep on looking at others, know what the person gets, what they have, what she has. The person will never say to Almighty, oh, Almighty, I'm grateful to what you've given me. So always the person keeps on looking at somebody else. And once you do that, what you even have, you will not appreciate it. And at the end, you will wind up losing it. You see, so Allah had given us Quran. That's the constitution of the whole world. Do you know what the Almighty says in Quran? In Quran chapter 50, in Quran in chapter 3, Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned verse number 18 in Surah Ali Imran. Verily, Almighty had borne witness that there is none worthy of worship and recognition except He Himself. And those who also bore witness, just like the way God Almighty said, are angels. And nobody will recognize this in detail except those blessed with knowledge. وَأُولُو الْعِلْمِ قَائِمًا بِالْقِسْطِ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُوَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ. So this is what Almighty mentioned. And Almighty also says that if you were to bring the whole mankind all together and convene them in one single spot, all of them all together, and if you were to examine the best out of all, the whole humankind at large, the best will be Muslims, and the best among Muslims will be the believers, and the best among the believers will be those blessed with knowledge. In chapter 58, page 543, verse 11, Almighty says, O ye who believe, يا أيها الذين آمنوا إذا قيل لكم تفسحوا في المجالس فافسحوا يفسح الله لكم وإذا قيل انشزوا فانشزوا يرفع الله الذين آمنوا منكم والذين أوتوا العلم درجات. Oh, you who believe, whenever it is said to you that come out for the pleasure of Allah, or you sit in a circle, somebody came. And I admire what you just did, because our grandmother, she just came and you gave her the seat. May Allah bless you. So when a person comes in a circle, Almighty says, give the person a place to sit. And whenever Almighty invites you to some, make sure you respond to his invitation. That is because Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he raises the status of those who had iman and those who had believed in Almighty. Allah said, we made you, the believers, to be above everybody. But as for those who are blessed with knowledge, Allah said, we raise them above the believers. And those who have the knowledge among themselves, Allah said, they are not on the same level. Therefore, those on the highest level, they're on the top. So this is what Almighty said, talking about knowledge. And also, when I make a U-turn, when possible, going and visiting another chapter in Quran, surah called Surah Az-Zumar or At-Tawheed, in chapter 39, page 459, verse 9, Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala said, هَلْ يَسْتَوِي الَّذِينَ يَعْلَمُونَ وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. If you don't know the power of knowledge, you tell me. The Creator says, you tell me, are they equal? Will they be the same? Those with knowledge and the ignorant, are they the same? Absolutely not. Nobody knows this in reality except those who had been blessed with intellect. إِنَّمَا يَتَذَكَّرُ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ. You see how it is? So here, what we're talking about, knowledge is what governs. You have it, you move forward. But knowledge will never be inherited at all. You can inherit somebody's wealth, you can inherit somebody's property, but you cannot inherit his knowledge unless you embark upon his own footsteps and way in order for you to be blessed with knowledge also. So if you sit down being lackadaisical and lazy, sitting in your sofa chair and very, you know, lazy chair, and you say, you know what, let me just say to you, my father is knowledgeable, the knowledge will just jump and come to my head. Well, sit there until you die. The knowledge will not come. You have to stand up for it. And do you know some? Once you stand up for that knowledge and you start searching and going deeply in searching for knowledge, Almighty will give it to you. So that's why we, the parents, we have to know, if Almighty had blessed you with a child, there's nothing more valuable that you can give to that child as a gift better than knowledge. You want to leave him that nice porch? You want to build a big house and get some nice bungalow for him? You're trying to get, you know, some nice Bentley for your child? You're trying to get, you know, them nice Ferrari for your child. You're trying to get them nice Range Rover for your child. Well, you can get him all this. But when he grows up and realizes that you did not put effort in his education, and now his own parents and his own colleagues and his own friends, they're above him, he will never value all what you gave him because you've deprived him of knowledge. So that's the knowledge, Ikhwan. That's the knowledge. The power of it is beyond our apprehension and beyond. So those who are listening today, and our viewers also here, ink whatever is coming so that you can have it unindelible throughout your life. So once you have the knowledge, you will be able to move. That's why our messenger, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was reported to have said, wherever you can search and seek knowledge, stand up and search and seek that knowledge, Because that is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given Muslims. And one of the unique things that Almighty Allah had blessed this ummah is the Quran that He gave us. All the books before Quran had been altered and simply changed except this Quran. The only scripture in the whole world that there is no way for you to find any contradiction is the text that came upon this ummah, the ummah of the final prophet. This is the Quran of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, if you bring all the leaders of the world, bring the monks, bring the bishops, bring the fathers, and bring all the leaders of the world, and the Christians, bring the Jews, all of them all together. Ask them to write one single book, not the whole book. Ask them to write the first book of Bible, Genesis, for instance. They will never be able to produce 5 verses consecutively, assiduously, without mistakes. Pope Benedict cannot defy. Pope John Paul, before his death, did not deny. Why? Because it's a book that those who came before, they altered some things just to suit their own way. But as for Quran, the whole chapters of Quran, a book with 114 chapters, more than 6,665 verses, the book that has these chapters and verses, if you bring a person who had memorized the whole Quran from China, another Hafiz from Africa, another one from Middle East, another one from Asia, another one from Europe, and they never met each other and they never set their eyes upon one another, and ask them to recite from A to Z, they will recite from A to Z without a single mistake. Nobody had done this except the one who has the power to say B, and it is. So this is Quran. They can recite it. And do you know the miracle of this book? Is that those who receive the book themselves, we know that the final prophet was among Arabs. So another proof for us to know that this book is from Almighty Allah. It's not written by men. It's not written by any human being. It's directly from Almighty Allah. Another proof for that is that those who memorize in Quran today, the majority of people who memorize in Quran today are not even Arabs. Because if the book was for Arabs, only Arabs would be memorizing the Quran. But you travel through the world, now you go to Nigeria, go to Ghana, go to Somalia, you know, go to Chad, and see the amount of people that are memorizing Quran, they're memorizing until the Quran turns into just like a stamp in their hearts. Now, if you were to open their hearts, you will have Quran there vividly. They remember Quran, but they do not even understand the language of Quran. We have some young boys that memorize Quran, and all that, if you ask them, you know, come here, let me kill you in Arabic, they don't even understand what you say. But they have the book in their heart. That's a miracle of Quran. In America, if you go to Midwest, in the states over there, for instance, Minnesota or Ohio, just go, or you go to, you know, Tukwila, Washington, or Seattle, Washington, or go to Toronto, out of America, or this part, go to another part of North America, I'm talking about Canada, go to Toronto, for instance, or go to Alberta, Canada, Edmonton, and see the amount of Somali kids that memorizing Quran. You can never find this kind of kids even in the Arab world. There's a community that I visit at least once a year. At least once a year. I'm supposed to be going there at least twice or thrice a year, but due to the calendar, I cannot go all the time, so only once a year I go there. Whenever I leave those kids, by the time I return back to them, guess what? More than 200 to 300 kids will memorize Quran. Go to Minnesota, you're going to say it. Go to Seattle, Washington, you're going to say it. And that's what we're establishing also here in Al Minhal and South Plainfield. So we invite you to come check it out. Come check it out, see them young kids. They will just open their mouths, just reciting. I saw one of the students as I entered the masjid. You see? So there's nothing that we can give those young ones better than knowledge. So let's try our best and sacrifice to give them that knowledge. And do you know some? A doctor is a doctor. An engineer will remain so. Physician will remain the same. All the knowledge that I'm talking about, the knowledge, the best of the best, and the best knowledge is the knowledge of Quran and the knowledge of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. MashaAllah. So that means we have some group back there. May Allah bless them. Okay, that's what's up. That's whom Allahu Akbar. That's good. You see? So that knowledge is the best. But most of us nowadays, especially Muslims, as I said earlier, when you are blessed with something, you don't know the value of it until it's taken. Most of us, we say, you know what? I was born a Muslim. My father was a Muslim. My mother was a Muslima. We are all from Muslim families. So it's not a big deal learning Quran. It's not a big deal memorizing or putting my child to memorize Quran and all that. You know, it's not a big deal and all that kind of stuff. You know, I want my child, I don't want him to memorize Quran. You know, that's some kind of like desert stuff. I want my child to be a doctor. I want my child to be an engineer. I want my child to become somebody like the best surgeon in the whole America. So Quran is not going to make him like that. So all what I care about, I don't want to waste my child's time and life sending him to madrasa or sending him to Islamic school. You know, I just want him to be this. I just want him to be that. If that's what you sent up in your mind, you're going to be a loser and your child will be a loser in the future. Because the first key of knowledge is knowing what God revealed to the world. How can you know everything, thinking that you know everything, but you don't know what you created? The one who created you, you have no clue of what he revealed. How can you survive? It's like you driving a car, but you say, you know what? I don't like Japanese people. So I'm not gonna, but I love, you know, I know that I don't love them Japanese, but I love BMW. So when I get the car, I'm not gonna read the manual because for the most part, they don't want writing the manual and I don't want to read what they have written and they wrote down. So I'm not gonna read, I'm just gonna pop up in the car and jump in it. And you know what? I'm just going to start driving the car and I'm just going to start moving the car. Well, start moving the car and start moving the car. If you don't know what the car consists, you're just driving something that you're completely ignorant of. And right now, if you get stuck at night and you don't even know where the manual is, that's the time that you're going to say, where these Japanese put their manuals, man? Now you're going to cry because the time is, oh, now you're in danger. You're in danger. So when you see yourself in danger, now you want somebody's manual. That's how Muslims are. We've taken the Quran and we place the Quran in our bookshelves. We don't go to Quran until when the air of melancholy and deep dejection gathers around us and we're in trouble. And now when we in problems and we go to Juju man, he cannot solve our problems. And we go to Imam Dambori, he cannot solve our problem. And we go to Imam Gobed and he say he cannot solve our problems. So now we say, let's see what Allah has to do for us. So let's turn to Quran. Now that you're in trouble and nothing for you except now you're going back to it. And now when you go back to Quran, you can never find what you want in Quran because he made it to be behind you. So Allah said, if you don't respond to me the time I want you, I won't respond to you the time you want me. إذا سألك عبادي عني فإني قريب أجيب دعوة الداعي إذا دعاني فليستجيبوا لي وليؤمنوا بي لعلهم يرشدون. You have to respond. So if you want Almighty to respond to you, You have to respond to him the time he wants you, not the time you feel like it. It's time to pray. You know, well, I'm still watching. Let me see what who's going to win the game, Chelsea or Manchester.
You got it right.
You know, so, you see, the time is time to pray, but the sister sitting down, let me see what Oprah Winfrey had to say. It's time to pray. Let me check out the reality show. No, it's time to pray. Let me see the new, you know, Nigerian movie. It's time to pray. Let me see what the Ghanaian movie has to offer. It's time to pray. You know what? You know, let me play some Ludo until, you know, when I get free chance, I go respond to God. Now, when you're in trouble and you call upon Allah and he doesn't respond, don't blame Islam. Blame yourself. Because Islam is intact. Pharaoh, when he gets stuck in the water, he called upon God. God did not respond to him because when Pharaoh was in his own dominion and his own power, God Almighty invited him and said, you know what? I don't like to even respond to the God of Musa. I'm God by myself. Now when he gets stuck behind the eight balls and he called upon Allah and he said, now I believe in the Lord of Moses, God Almighty said, no, the time is over. Oh, no, the time is over. You can't get it again. But here is another slave of God, another bondman of Almighty Allah, Prophet Yunus. When he gets stuck in the water, just like Pharaoh did, when he called upon Allah, Allah said, we responded to him, even though he was not only in the bottom of the water, rather he was swallowed by the fish. So he was in the darkness upon the darkness of darkness. When darkness is asked, what is darkness? Darkness will tell you that darkness is in the womb of fish. So he was there. He cried to Almighty. When he said, Ya Allah, the whole angel said, Labbaik. Oh Allah, here is your slave. He's stuck. He's in trouble. So we want, we ask, and we plead on his own behalf. And we ask you, O Almighty. So we say Ameen for his dua. So Allah said we responded to his dua right away. Hadn't been that he was among those who used to glorify Allah, Allah said we would have left him there, even though he was a prophet. Even though he was a prophet, he would have been kept in there. Allah would have never allowed him to come out. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, as for Muslims, drive closer to Surah As-Saffat and get the point. Allah said that verily, wa inna yunusa lamina al-mursaleena idh abaqa ila al-fulki al-mash'oon fasahama fakana min al-mudahadeen faltaqamahu al-hootu wa huwa muleemun falawla annahu kana min al-musabbihina lalabi في بطنه إلى يوم يبعثون. That's what Allah said. So brothers and sisters, we have to make sure that we are aware of knowledge that Almighty had blessed us with in order for us to function and move forward. Why? Because this is what governs our life. So back to how to uplift ourselves with knowledge. The way to uplift yourself with knowledge, first and foremost, you have to believe that you as a slave, you're ignorant. I have to believe that I'm ignorant. If I don't believe myself that I'm ignorant, I have to go and learn. Whenever I sit in front of somebody to teach me, I may think, you know, I'm somebody. So that's when arrogance will step in. And once you're arrogant, the knowledge will leave you forever. Humbleness first. That's the first step to acquiring the best knowledge. If you're not humble, you will regardless. You will never. Let me tell you this. Do you remember Prophet Moses when Allah asked him to travel? In Sahih al-Bukhari, Prophet Musa was standing in front of the children of Israel. When they asked him, oh Prophet, is there anyone on the face of this earth more knowledgeable than you? Prophet Musa said, no. And rightly so, he was right. Why? Because he was a prophet receiving what? Why? He's receiving a revelation. So to whom? He is the best. Because if he was to say no, somebody will have doubt and say, well, then let me go search for somebody better than Musa and follow him. Why will I follow somebody who himself is not sure? So he said yes. And yes, he was, but because he does not have the knowledge of unseen. But if he was to have that knowledge, he would have said, no, there's a slave who has knowledge, more knowledge than me. So when he did not say that, Allah said, well, let's give him a lesson. So he put his own prophet upon the track of searching for knowledge. That's when he started traveling. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about Moses in Surah Al-Kahf in chapter 18, page number 300, from verse 60-61, he started the story. Prophet Moses said, if that's the case, if there's someone who is more knowledgeable than me, I don't care. Even it's going to take me hundreds of years to reach to this man, because of the benefit of knowledge, I will travel to that man. Hundreds of years. Let's see right now, if somebody was to drive from New York, or drive, let's say, from Philadelphia, or drive from Boston to come to this circle, he's going to, you know, regard himself, well, you know, I'm the man. You know, I drove all this mile just for the lecture. But this, he said, even years, I'm going to travel. وَإِذْ قَالَ مُوسَى لِفَتَاهُ لَا أَبْرَحُ حَتَّى أَبْلُغَ مَجْمَعَ الْبَحَرَيْنِ أَوْ أَمْضِيَ حُقُبًا فَلَمَّا بَلَغَ مَجْمَعَ بَيْنِهِمَا نَسِيَ حُوتَهُمَا فَاتَّخَذَ سَبِيلَهُ فِي الْبَحْرِ سَرَبًا فَلَمَّا جَاوَزَهُ قال لفتاه آتنا غدا أنا لقد لقينا من سفرنا هذا نصبا. I saw that she is following me, and I say page 300. So this page 300, that's where the story started. But after two verses, you have to open and flip to page 301. Otherwise, where I am right now, you're not gonna get it. So page 301, that's where I am right now. It's going to be, inshallah, tabarak wa ta'ala, it's going to be on your right side. So this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, أَوْ أَمْدُيَ حُقُبًا فَلَمَّا بَلَغَ مَجْمَعَ بَيْنِهِمَا نَسِيَ حُوتَهُمَا فَاتَّخَذَ سَبِيلَهُ فِي الْبَحْرِ. That's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. So here, he said, I'm going to travel until, you know, I meet this man. So do you know the amazing thing? Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to set up an example for us that the only way to get knowledge, if you want typical and unadulterated knowledge, humbleness is the first up for you. Why? That is because it's Maghrib time. Okay, Isha? Maghrib? Also, we stop and pray. Huh? We stop and pray? Okay, then we stop and pray. And inshallah, tabarak wa ta'ala, by 7, you know, by 7:15, I have to exit. I have a lecture in South Plainfield. I have another lecture. So I don't know how we're going to do it. I really, you know, enjoy being, you know, here today, subhanallah. It's just... Okay, how about, let me wrap it up. So if you have questions, so that when we pray, you know, the imam said, how about we do it? So inshallah, we go by what the imam said. So inshallah, I just wrap it up. You see, so let me go over it really quickly. You see, so Allah wanted to set up an example for us to know that if you are not humble, if you don't humble yourself, you will never get knowledge. Even you do, the knowledge is going to be against you. Why? Here is Prophet Musa, right? Among all the prophets and all the messengers, who is known to be Kalimullah? Who is Kalimullah? The one who has the title, Kalimullah. Do you know why he gained this title, Kalimullah? Because he spoke to Allah direct without nobody translating, without nobody taking the voice. Can you imagine talking to your creator directly and listening to the voice? How will you feel? Now, if you're sitting in your house and, you know, a phone call comes and you pick it up and then, hello, you say, this is Mr. Obama from the White House, you're going to tell your wife, you've been giving me hell. You see, even the president knows that I'm here. You're going to be so, you know, excited that Mr. President had called you. Now, we're not talking about presidents. We're not talking about governors. We're not talking about kings. We're talking about the King of Kings. The day when he asks, who are the kings? No king will speak. And nobody will challenge. So that's how it is. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said that actually we gave Kalimullah Musa this title for you to know that he spoke and he listened to the words of Allah direct. He listened to the sound of Allah direct. Yet, even though he is Kalimullah, by listening to the sound and the voice of Allah direct, he still has to sit down and learn from somebody. How about you and me and you and I that never even listened to the word of God? If he had listened to the voice of Almighty, yet he still have to sit down and learn. How about you and I? Have you heard the sound, the voice of Allah before? Our big, big sheikhs of the world, have they listened to the voice of Allah before? So if he had listened to the voice of Allah direct, yet he still has to travel to acquire knowledge. So that means you and I that never listened to the word of Allah, the sound of Allah, not his word, the voice of Allah direct. That means we are more worthy to start seeking and searching for knowledge. And guess what? Knowledge does not have age. That's another way of uplifting. That's the second point. Knowledge does not have age. Sometimes a person will say, you know, I'm already gray. You the kids, you know, that's your field. No. Prophet did not start learning the reality of life and Quran until after 40. That's when he just started. That's when the first verses started coming. Do you know, Imam, now if I ask you, who among you that had never ever heard the name of Imam al-Bukhari? Is there any? I don't believe, you know, you sitting here, you never heard the name Imam al-Bukhari. Because no Imam will stand on the minbar except in a Jumu'ah or two, he must quote from Imam al-Bukhari because of the value of his book. Do you know how long it took him to write that book? 16 years. So it's not like going to university, graduating and getting your bachelor's or PhD or master's here. And there. No. And do you know the one who explained Bukhari, the best explanation of Bukhari, do you know the name of that book is called Fathul Bari. You know how long it took the author to explain Bukhari? It took Imam al-Bukhari 16 years to write down the book. It took Imam Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani 35 years to explain that book. And here is Imam Abu al-Qasim. Most of you sitting here, you're going to say, yeah, we Maliki from Maliki's school of thought. Okay, let me tell you, one of the best students of Imam Malik, that when you open the book of Imam Malik, we're going to see his name over and over, is Al-Qasim, Abu al-Qasim. This Imam, originally he's from Egypt, he was from Egypt. He heard about Imam Malik in Medina. At the time, there wasn't no flight, there wasn't no cars, there wasn't no jet, there wasn't nothing. He started traveling to Imam Malik just to seek knowledge. He left his wife when she was pregnant to go to Imam Malik and search for knowledge and seek and bring it back to his people and benefit them. Do you know what happened? A 17-year boy came to Medina once. He was asking, who is Abu al-Qasim? He said, here I am, I am al-Qasim. He said, I am the one whom you left in the womb of my mother. I don't know, the voice reaches them after a second. You see? So that's how it is. 17 years sitting down. That's why, you know, the reason why we don't have the type of blessing as those people? Because those people, they took knowledge as worship. So they search and seek for knowledge to benefit people. But as for us today, with our imams and our leaders, you know, we search for knowledge in order for me to come combat and also attack this person and say this person had no knowledge and this imam, he doesn't have even PhD and this imam, he never graduated from university and this. So we just fighting and we leave our people in darkness and they hungry and they really, really hungry for knowledge, but we don't give them because we engage of fighting among ourselves. But those people, they understood that knowledge is teaching, and that's the power. So they started searching for it. Do you know Imam Ibn Manda? Imam Ibn Manda, he left his country when he was 25 years. He did not return back to his country until he turned, when the time he turned 65 is when he returned back. How many years did he live? 40. How many?
40.
All in knowledge. Can you imagine this? And some of them, I tell you, they started after they were 60. If I ask our mothers right now to open Quran, I really admire, she has a Quran widely open. I mean, Allah bless you and bless everybody. You see, having the Quran, you know, my mother don't say I'm old. Knowledge does not know age. Knowledge only knows effort. That's what knowledge knows. Knowledge knows effort. I was in Washington, in Seattle, Washington, 5 years ago. Do you know? There was a lady who said to herself, I actually vow to memorize the Quran of Allah before I meet Allah. So I want Allah to regard me as one of the memorizers of his book before I meet Allah. She started memorizing. By the time she finished, she started, she was 70 years old. When she turned 75, she finished. 75 years. I went to Ohio, you know, a year after that, and then I was talking to, you know, some group of, you know, students, but I hided her age. So somebody, when I finished, she said, wow, after 5 years, that lady, she finished memorizing Quran. One of the youth, he asked me, he said, Brother Imam, is she married? I said, no, she's not married. She's waiting for you to pay her dowry. And then you're going to get married, inshallah, when she turns 78. He said, wow, oh, Brother Imam, thank you so much for that information. You see? So that's knowledge. Knowledge only knows effort. No age. Let me set up a racket straight so that I can close for us to pray. You know, because if I leave without fixing this problem, I don't think my mothers and my sisters will open the door for me to leave tonight. So I have to set up this racket straight. I said, he left to Medina when his wife was pregnant. His sister will say, well, are you telling our husband to leave us while pregnant and go out? That's not what I'm saying. If he does that, that's between you and the house. I'm not part of it. I'm just giving you some information. Huh? You see? So that's the power of knowledge. So make sure, first and foremost, humbleness in knowledge. Because when Moses traveled to this man, he asked him, can I sit down in front of you to learn? He did not say, when he met Khadr, the one whom Prophet Musa went to learn from, when he went home, he did not say, Prophet Musa, you know, guess what, I'm a prophet. He did not say Khadr, Prophet Musa did not say Khadr, alayhi salam, I'm a prophet, so you have to make sure you make time for me because I came here purposely for you, so teach me before I leave, otherwise you're going to be in trouble with Allah because I'm a prophet. He didn't say that. He said, can I have your permission to sit before you to learn? That's the humbleness. So, how to uplift ourselves with knowledge? One, humble yourself for knowledge, you will get it. Two, you have to make sure that the knowledge that you're trying to acquire has some pillars. What was the second one that I mentioned, if you remember?
There's no age.
Aywa. Don't say that's for my baby, that's for my son. You want to meet Allah on the day of Qiyamah and you know something about his deen. Just like the way you just went to university or college or high school, you get your diploma here. Why? Because on the day of judgment, do you know something? Allah will invite our sisters and invite our brothers, and Allah will invite each and every one of us. He will say to Sister Fatima, come up front. Brother Muhammad, come up front. Brother Yaqub, come up front. I want you all my slaves, you coming in front of me to recite. And we will never let you stop until you yourself stop. And each and every verse that you will recite, it will be like another level of paradise for you. So the more ayat that you know, the more you build for yourself. يقال لصاحب القرآن. So I encourage my sisters, my mothers, my brothers, my fathers, try your best. Knowledge does not have age. It's effort that once you put in it. Imam, many imams that you know, they started searching and seeking knowledge after the age of 60. So you still have the chance. Especially the deen. The knowledge of the deen about Allah, knowing who Allah is and worship him. The reason why we have a lot of even innovations today, we just worship without knowing. A person will come to Imam, Brother Imam, you know, I did this. Is that okay in the religion? You see, like they say in the house, I don't know whether you will understand me because a very long time I didn't speak the language and you know my house is gone. So I apologize if I get it guala way. You know, they say, you know, bayan akuya tachi gari. Is that right? You see? After the, what was akuya again? After goat. After goat had finished eating. I don't even know what gari is. After goat had finished eating the, you know, the dust for whatever flour that we use. Now you're trying to chase it. They finish eating. That's it. It's just like a man who was eating, like I told him before, he was eating. And the eagle came and snatched his food. He tried to jump and get it. He couldn't get the food back. He said, you know, fi sabilillah. Now that he finished losing his food, he's saying, fi sabilillah. You see, he tried to snatch it back. He couldn't get it. You see that? You see, so that's how it is. So sisters, brothers, fathers, you know, mothers, all of you, the best thing that you can equip yourself with is knowledge. Try your best. Search and seek the knowledge of your deen. That's the most important. After that, never allow. You know, I can understand you say going to, you know, to school, back to school, getting PhD and all that, and I'm old. I can understand that. But when it comes to your deen is all the way till you die. You know, PhD, bachelor's, whatever, whatever. I want to become the theologian of the whole world. I want to be the new, you know, Steve Jobs. I want to be the new Isaac Newton. I want to be the new Lindbergh. I want to be the new, you know, whatever kafirs that they have accumulated. I want to be on the top as a Muslim. And I want to be the best Leonardo da Vinci. I can understand that if you're old, you may not be able to do that in that part because that has a limit. But when it comes to your deen, Allah said, "Wa'bud Rabbaka hatta ya'tiyaka al-yaqeen." The knowledge of the deen until the day you open your eyes and nobody in front of you but the angel of death. That's the end of knowledge. And I will conclude before I take much of your time, finally conclude by saying, if you think the knowledge of the deen, and I said to you, both knowledge, the worldly knowledge is important in our lives, especially Muslims. Getting your degree, graduating, all that is vitally important in our religion. But the knowledge of religion takes the precedence in every aspect of life. So when you get this, try to seek and search for this one. That is because a doctor is only a doctor in the world. An engineer is only an engineer in the world. Computer scientist is only computer scientist in the world. When a doctor dies, computer scientist or astronaut, once you die in your grave, that actually title will be taken from you. It's over. But do you know the only one who will keep his title? The one who became knowledgeable in the deen. If you have the knowledge of Quran, you will still keep that title. Because in the grave, if the angel wakes you up and they ask you, hey, Muhammad, what did you bring here? You know, you see, I graduated from Yale University and I did my bachelor's from Oxford. And at the end, I get some thesis submitted over there in Cambridge. And at the end, what I did is that in Oxford, I became professor. The angel will strike you with the big gongulungu. Even if you were to open your eyes, only Allah knows where you're going to be. Huh? Did I say it right? How do y'all say it? Huh? Koboko? Oh, I apologize. I didn't know how to say it. I apologize. Koboko, right? Okay, the angels will kobokolize you in the grave. You see? So that's how it is. Brothers and sisters, I appreciate your company today. And I hope and pray, inshallah, I see you another time. Inshallah, where we have enough time, I just apologize. Inshallah, I will try. Inshallah, if I have another time, maybe, inshallah, we try to make some room after Ramadan, if possible. If not Ramadan, the next year we make it, inshallah, ta'ala. Bi-idhnillahi tabarak wa ta'ala. So keep me in dua. I appreciate your, you know, presence today. And I thank my media team. And I welcome and I also pray to Allah to bless our imam. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the chance that he gave us today to, you know, discuss some things of the deen, which you may Allah reward your imam. And may Allah keep him strong. And the brother who anticipated this circle, I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless him. And all the brothers and all the sisters that came here today, regardless of your background, ethnicity, and your country, I ask Allah to bless you as well. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bring all of us in Jannah on the day of judgment. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless our parents so that they can get a lot of dollars that will benefit them to do a lot of yayi for them. Allahumma ameen. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Thumma assalatu wassalamu sarmada ala khitami al-anbiya'i ahmada wa alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Ya Rabbi walhiqna bihim ameen. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.